old men, women, and children who had lost their villages became guerrilla fighters. They formed bands to sabotage and harass the Germans from behind the lines. The main German offensives were directed against Leningrad in the north, Moscow in the center, and the Caucasus in the south. The Russians, in desperate battles, counterattacked and checked the advance on Leningrad and Moscow. But in the south, on July 1st, 1942, after a siege of 180 days, Sevastopol fell. The German army now massed for an all-out drive on Stalingrad and the Caucasus. The conquest of the Caucasus and the capture of Stalingrad would block Russia's vital Middle East oil supply and make this oil available for the German war machine. Simultaneously in Africa, other German forces were driving for Suez to cut the British lifeline of supply.
This was the North African front in 1942. The outnumbered and poorly equipped British Empire and fighting French forces had to retreat before the German advance. They were driven back across the desert to El Alamein, only 60 miles from Alexandria, key to the Suez Canal.
And on the Pacific front in 1942, the Japanese had spread like locusts over the eastern archipelago. Following the bombing of Pearl Harbor, the Japanese had taken the American outposts of Wake and Guam. Hong Kong fell. Thailand yielded. The Philippines fell. And in swift succession, Singapore, Burma, the Netherlands East Indies, New Guinea, New Britain, the Solomon. Attu and Kiska in the American Aleutian Islands. The Allied line of defense in the Pacific was pushed back to an arc which pivoted on the Hawaiian Islands in the center. Near Pearl Harbor, and essential to its defense, is the American outpost of Midway. If this defense line were to be breached, the United States Navy would be swept from the Pacific. On June 3rd, 1942, American patrols sighted Japanese warships and troop transports several hundred miles out at sea, heading for this island of Midway. Upon Admiral Nimitz, commander of the Central Pacific Front, rested a grave responsibility. He decided that this was the place to make a stand and committed all available ships to a bold attack. The future of the Pacific lay in the hands of these young naval aviators. This was a new kind of sea battle. The two fleets were never within sight of each other. Aircraft carriers, great floating airports, served as bases from which the planes took off to attack the opposing fleet over 100 miles away. The Battle of Midway set the pattern for other sea battles which followed in the Pacific. While the American planes were on their mission, Japanese planes in turn attacked the American fleet. United States lost one destroyer and the aircraft carrier Yorktown, one of the only three undamaged American carriers in the Pacific. But simultaneously, American planes had been giving the Japanese a savage hammer. Japanese task force was routed. They lost 4 modern aircraft carriers, 2 heavy cruisers, 3 destroyers, and suffered severe damage to other ships, including battleships. The Battle of Midway was a defensive battle only, but it marked a turning point in the Pacific War.
Simultaneously in Egypt, the Allied armies were preparing for their crucial battle at El Alamein, 60 miles from Alexandria. In spite of their defeats, this army had remained largely intact, thanks to the gallant stand of the fighting French at Bir Hakeim under General Koenig. In August 1942, the Germans under Marshal Rommel sent in tanks to breach a hole in the Allied lines through which the infantry could follow. This was the accepted blitzkrieg tactic. Massed British artillery and armored forces allowed the tanks to pass through their lines. They then closed in and destroyed them. ...300 tanks of the German Africa Corps were left burning in the desert. This, too, was a defensive victory only, but it marked the turning point in the African campaign. The German advance was stopped. Suez was safe.
And on the Russian front, the crisis was nearing at Stalingrad, key to Russia's supply line. For 40 days and 40 nights, the Germans had been hammering at the city. Time after time, Hitler had promised his people, Stalingrad will be ours. But Marshal Stalin had said to his armies, not one step back. Germany threw thousands of men, enormous amounts of material, into the fight. But stubbornly, the Russians fought on, behind crumbling walls, in suburban gardens, in factories, in houses, on stairways. And Stalingrad held.
Here, in the streets of Stalingrad, as in the Egyptian desert, off a tiny sand spit in mid-Pacific, were fought the battles which changed the course of history. To the young Russians, British, Frenchmen, and Americans who died in these battles, the free world will forever be in debt. By the summer of 1942, materials for war were coming in ever-increasing numbers from the production line. Britain's factories were going 24 hours a day, with every able-bodied man in uniform. 75% of the work was being done by women. Work stopped only when enemy bombers were directly overhead. In Russia, though some factories were bombed and destroyed again and again, the workers continued to produce among the ruins.
If you enjoyed that, you may enjoy some of my other World War II videos. I have three World War II playlists, one of general videos, one with newsreel footage, and another concentrating on the efforts of women during World War II. Check out my channel for other interesting videos on a variety of topics, and subscribe because we'll be adding lots of new video, including new World War II footage.